So I'm going to talk about how to manage the changes in database. And that's the topic for today. I was first thinking to make demos, but I only have 45 minutes, so I'm actually going to just explain how it works. If we have time in the end, then I probably make some demos, but let's see how it goes. So I have graduated from Helsinki University. I have a master's degree in computer science. I'm a Finn, and I hate to speak about myself, so this is the only slide about me. I'm not going to read it to you. But I'm, as Natalie already said, I'm a proud author of this book. It's out on Monday, and it's already in US, actually. And I was trying to get the copies here, and already promised I will have a couple of copies. But to my surprise, and I think even for the price to the publisher, it's selling very good in US. So they don't give me any copies in Europe. Only in June, they said. So I guess I'm happy, but I'm a bit disappointed because I'm European. So they should give me all the copies and not the Americans. So anyway, I have one copy with me. I was really fighting for this copy because I promised I will have copies with me. And she will tell me who will have it, and then we will sign it together. So the problem. My presentation is not going to be funny like the previous one. I'm trying to be very serious. We're talking about the problem, the changes. There are new tables, new views, new columns. There are all kind of changes, column modifications, constraints, that kind of things in the database. And how can you handle those? You're removing tables, you're doing this and that. How do you handle all this? You also have changes in code. Do you have a problem with that? Sometimes, Well, I used to be a developer, but for some reason they don't let me develop anymore. I don't know what's the strange reason for that, but my husband is still a developer. And I asked him and he said, we don't have any problems. I said, that's good, I'm so happy. But how to control everything, and especially the data, that's usually the biggest problem. I don't have very good answers for the data. I have some slight answers for that, but not a serious one. But I do have answers for the structures. So the solution, you already know how to handle it with your code. You know how to know which code part is where and which are the versions you have, which are the releases, whatever terminologies you're using. So just a comment here. I'm not going to use one particular terminology, so not a particular method or anything. I'm not going to talk about DevOps or some kind of agile kind of thing. I'm just talking about processing things. So the terms I'm trying to use are very general terms. So not a particular methodology here. Any kind of methodology that is agile kind. So don't worry if the word that I'm using is not the word that you are using in your company. It still applies to you as well. But I'm just trying to use very common terminologies. So, but you don't have the problem with the code, so why would you have a problem with the database structures? Because it's actually the same thing. So if you already have a system implemented in your company for versioning the code, use the same one for your database. How can you do it? First of all, use this tool. It's from Oracle and it's a free tool. So you can just download and start using. You don't have to pay anybody anything. Okay? That's the first thing, because if you're only using paper and a pen, you can't do anything. You need to have a tool. Okay? Does anybody disagree on this? No, you need to have a tool. Use Subversion. Why? Because Subversion is integrated in Data Modeler. I know you're probably using Git and you're using something else with your code, but, sorry, can't get everything. But anyway, you have a version control tool you can use with Data Modeler, and Subversion is not too bad. Okay? Use the same labeling for versions, releases, whatever you call them, as you are using for the code. So when you release something 1.1 with your code, release also 1.1 with your database. So you know exactly that's the same version. So whatever the labeling, numbering, whatever system you are using, use the same one with the database. And whatever the system is that you are using, use that as well. So the system and the numbering use the same thing. And And just a little tiny detail here. In Data Modeler, you can also create templates. So whenever you commit something to version control, you will have this template to fill up. So you can ask about version number or whatever, so you will always have the template just to fill it up. It will make your life easier. That's why I put it here, because otherwise I will forget it. It's so self-evident. So one common use case is, this happens to me every time, every day. I need version 1.1 of the database for my tests, and I need it now. Have you ever heard that? Me too. Yes, I know. It happens to me every day. I don't have to worry about it anymore because I have those versions. It takes me 5 minutes and everything is set up. So it's good to be prepared because this question will come up. So how I do it? I go to, I'm using, all the time that I'm using here is this tool. I'm not using Subversion by itself, I'm just using the tool. So in the tool I go and say check out from Subversion, and I take my Riga, I have a design called Riga. So in this tool, a design is everything that is inside of one database thing. You have your entities, your tables, your multidimensional models, your physical layers, everything that is related to this one particular design is called a design. And each element will have its own XML file. Okay? So that's what I'm referring to now. I have a design called Riga. And I go and see all the revisions I have. And because I was very smart, I actually put in my comment version 1.1, so I can just see from the comment which version is the one that I was asked for. So this is just one way of doing it, very simple way. So I just go and take the revision which I labeled as version 1.1, and I checked it out, and now I open the design from my working directory, and I start working. I have it open in my data modeler now, and I can do with it whatever I want to do. Probably I want to get the DDLs, because I was asked for this particular version of database. How do I do it? So it's open in my tool, and I go to File and Export, and I say DDL file. First, what I have to tell is what kind of database I need the DDLs for. Is it going to be Oracle, SQL Server, DB2, what kind of database, and which version? So I want to have the DDLs for Oracle 12c. Then I can decide what elements I want to have. Do I want to have everything I have in my design, or just some tables, or maybe just one particular view? So I can go here and decide. I'm not used to having, so I can just walk. So I can go here and say tables, and pick just one or two tables if I want, and deselect everything else. So the DDL will only include those tables. Or I can just say, bring me everything, and I will create the database as it is in version 1.1. Okay? So this is how the DDL will look like. By the way, I forgot to say, you can also decide here if you want to have regular DDLs or if you want to have interactive ones. But I'm taking just the regular ones. So this is how it looks like. Yes? It's asking the questions. I am going to create a table, press enter, that kind of.
The difference between the regulars and interactive ones, what is it?
Interactive one is the one that the tool is asking you questions. So the SQL is writing, it will have procedures and packages and that kind of things. And it will ask you, I'm going to create this table, press enter when you're happy with it, and you're pressing enter. But this is the one that you usually use, the regular kind of SQL. But it's capable of doing many kind. So that's how it looks like. Now I can just go here and save it as a file and run it to any database I want to. I can find a particular word if I want to, and it will just search the whole thing through. By the way, if I wanted to have separate files for each table, for instance, I just go and click this one, and the file will not be a total file, it will be plenty of files. And it will create me the structure as well, the directories and the files. But that's a detail. But anyway, I will get the DDL, which I can save and run. And there you have your database of DruckServe version 1.1. But there is no data because this is just creating the database. So I have to have a plan B for getting the data. And it depends on what kind of changes I had. Okay? If we are using branches, for instance, so whenever we release something, we create a branch of our code. We can do the same with our database design as well. We can create a branch, which is of course easier because then you just go to the branches and you take Riga 1.1 and you check it out and you open it. Also possible. So whatever the system is that you are using, use the same thing with your database code. This is code, XML code. So just check it out from the branch and open it. That's how it works. And whatever the system is that you are using, I'm pretty sure you can do it with the tool as well. But use the same one because you already implemented it in your code. So why not implement it with your database design as well? Don't have separate processes. So another very common use case to me is that people come to me and say, what has changed in version 3.5 compared to version 1.1? Or another one is, I have 1.1, but I already have my data inside. Please upgrade it to 3.5 without losing my data. I can do that as well. Let's see what I do now. So, you already know how to get those versions from the version control. So you just download, check out them from version control to your working directory and open with the tool. That's what you do. And it's important now to decide what are you comparing to what. Are you going to compare 1.1 to 3.5 or 3.5 to 1.1? Which way? Which one are you going to change to each other? That's the question here. So when we want to compare designs, because now there are designs to my terminology, there's two ways of doing it. Either you can use file import and data model design, which will compare everything, entities, everything. Or you can use tools compare merge models, which will just compare relational and physical models, which means the tables and the interpretation of Oracle 12c or SQL Server version something. Okay? But the good thing with this latter one here is that you will get the auto DDLs if you need them, which means that you can just change the structure without losing the data. So first we will see this import part, which compares everything. So first I select, am I losing my voice? No. First I select which model I'm importing, and I can say here either import it to a new relational model, which will actually create me a new relational model, not compare anything, or I can say bring it to my existing relational underscore one relational model, which means it's going to compare. So the one I have open will be compared to the one that I'm just importing now. Please ask questions if I'm not making it clear. Good. Because sometimes I assume everybody knows everything because I already know it. And I do the same with my kids and they get very annoyed. They are 16 and 18 and they know everything better than I do. So I sometimes do the same trick for them as well. Okay, so this is what opens next. You can see exactly what has changed. Here, I have this kind of tables, and this green plus means it actually it's a new table that doesn't exist here. So it depends on which way I'm comparing now. I'm comparing 1.1 to 3.5 or the other way. So this is the one I have, and this is the one I'm comparing to. And I'm going to have the changes done if I want to. I can see all the details. I can see that the person table has been changed. This triangle shows has been changed. I can go and see what actually changed. Comment, because it's shown in red. Somebody has added a comment here, which doesn't exist in my source, but it is in the target. So if I want to get this comment in my source, the one that I'm comparing to design, I just click this one and I say apply, and it will be changed. So I can see very detailed columns changed, primary key or unique key changes here, new things, and if there's a red cross, which means it's been deleted. very, very detailed. I can also, what we saw before was the tree view, but I could also go to tabular view, which actually allows me to run reports. The report will just give me a report, what are the differences? So if somebody asks me, how does 3.5 different from 1.1, I can just run the report and give the report, and say, this is how they change, how it's been changed. What do you want me to do now? So maybe they want me to actually go back with some of the changes we made because they were not correct, and they can show me from the report, these are the things that are actually not correct. I want you to go back two versions down, for instance. So the report can be very handy someday. The other thing I just mentioned earlier was the compare merge models, which compares the model that is open to the one that you are just importing into, or what would be the right word, bringing into the tool. And it only compares relational, which is the tables, and the physical model, which is the physical part of the design. This is how we do it. So my source, I might have several relational models in my design. So I can have one logical model, which can have several relational models, which can have several physical models. So if I have several relational models, let's say I have inheritance and I want to have different ways of doing inheritance in my tables, I can have separate relational models for that, for some reason. Or whatever reason that I want to have different kind of relational models, I might have several of those. So here I tell which one is the one I want to compare to. And also the target might have several relational models, and I can select which one is the one I want to compare to. So the usual case is I have one logical, one relational, and one physical, but I can have plenty in one design. Then I decide the physical one, Oracle 12c, SQL Server something, etc. And we'll talk about this a bit later. And this is what I get. It looks exactly the same that we just saw before, but I don't have entities anymore here. I just have tables, and I have the physical elements. And I can see that the schema actually has been changed. I didn't have any schema in my source for this table CPY, but I do have a schema in my target database. If I want it to be copied here, I can just select and say merge. If I don't want to, I don't have to. I can also say DDL preview, which will actually show me if I have selected this, but I say DDL preview, I can see how it will be changed in SQL if I want it to be done. Then I have another example. Well, table space has been added. I might want to do it. A lot of physical elements. I can also say that this table should be recreated. I can define things for that, but this is something I wanted to mention. What I see here is that in my source, I have this common property column, which being varchar 2.10, but in my new version, I have number 10. So the data type has been changed. What can I do? I can tell the tool that I want to recreate the table and generate the SQL for me for that. So what it will do, I have my table. It will create a new table with the right kind of data type. It will take all the data to the new one and drop the previous table. So all these DDLs and all these SQLs will be generated automatically for me. Of course, you have to check that it's correct. It's just a tool, but it does work. So you can just tell the tool that, okay, I'm happy with the change. Please help me to implement it without losing my data. Just one example. So here's an example of the DDLs I actually got from here. I say DDL preview, so I'm not running any DDL anywhere in database, I'm just seeing the DDL preview. If I want to save it, I can again save it, and I will have this whatever SQL. I can run it any database. Or I can find, again, if I want to find something, errors or whatever in my SQL. One more use case that often comes to me is that people come and ask about database, the real database and my design, something that they want to compare those two things. Is my design up to date compared to the database? Has somebody changed the database without changing the design? So maybe the design is actually version 3.6 and my design is only 3.5. Could happen sometimes if people don't follow the process. Do I have changes in my design I have forgotten to implement to the database? So the database is actually behind. My design is 3.6, but database is 3.5, and I don't remember. I actually forgot to do the changes for my database. Is the test database in the same level with the production database? I have a customer who says, yes, it is, until we hit the bug. No, it isn't. Why isn't? Oh, not sure. So what's different? Don't know. So but the last one I will explain now before we go to the slides. What you can do is that you have test database and you have the production database. So you just import everything from the test database as a design. Then you import everything from the production database as a design. Now you have two designs. You have the full documented database, test and production. And you already learned that you can compare two designs to each other. This way or that way or any way. Then you can just compare them and see what has actually changed. What's different between those two databases? Very simple. Okay, so now we're going to compare design and a database. There's four ways of doing that. First of all, you can synchronize model with data dictionary, which means that the target is the model. The changes will be implemented to the model. Another one is synchronize data dictionary with model, which means that the target is the database. So you will get the auto DDLs to change the database according to the design. Then you can also use file import DDL file, which will import your DDL file into tool. So if you have a design open in the tool and you import the DDL, you can compare the design and the DDL you are importing to each other. And you know how they differ. Or the last one is you have your design open and you import from data dictionary directly from the database and you compare those two, the design and what you are importing from the database. And you know immediately what is different. And always remember, you can compare each way. So one is always the target and one is the source. So here's where you find the synchronized model with data dictionary. It's here. So in the tool, I'm not going to details with the tool because I only have this 45 minutes. If I have in the end, I will show a little bit of the tool, but if not, I would just show quickly. So there's always these icons that are valid, whatever you are doing at the moment. So if I'm working with a relational model, I will have these available. Synchronized model with data dictionary and, okay, I will show some details. And the other one, which will have the opposite effect, comparing to the other one to the other one. So what I do first, I need to have the connection to the database, of course, otherwise it won't know where the database exists and what it does have in it. So I have to have a connection. I already have a connection created here, but if I don't, then I have to create it, of course. Tell which database and what credentials I have. And it looks, again, very same that we saw before. So all these comparings, even though you come from different directions and different ways of the tool, you will always see a very familiar screen. So you will get used to it very, very fast. And always the same thing, you will have green plus, yellow triangle, and this red cross, telling you what actually has happened. I have a new table, I have changes in table, and I have one table I should actually drop. So now I'm comparing the database and my design. My design has a table which my database doesn't have. So it just suggests me to drop it because it's not a legal table. Maybe it is. Maybe I'm just comparing the wrong way. Maybe not. But at least I know that there's a difference between those two. And again, I have all these here. I have the details, storage option, blah, 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 and also the data type conversion from number to varchar or whatever you are changing. And this is the other way. when you are synchronizing data dictionary with a model. Again, first the connection, of course. Now it looks very different because we are comparing my design to the real database. It looks very different because it depends which one you are comparing to. Again, I can have a video preview if I want to. For me, that usually clarifies what's actually happening because SQL is something I can read. So I quite often take the DDL preview and I see what's actually changing. And one thing I have to mention to you, I forgot to say, these are always not, these are disabled when it's drop. So nothing will be dropped by accident if you just go and say, do it, whatever you're doing. So drop is always disabled, and create and change is always enabled by default. But of course you can go and change it. But the thing is that you will not accidentally drop anything. That's good to know. Okay, here's the DDL again. That's how it looks like. And one thing that is quite common is that I have actually renamed a column. So in my design, I have renamed it. It used to be named DSC, but I actually renamed it DSC New. And now the tool is telling me that actually you should create a new column here, and you should drop this one here. Fine, I can do that if I have an empty database, but if I don't have, and I want to keep my data, I actually have to tell the tool that no, this is the same column as this one here, I just renamed it. So I right-click and I say map to existing column. Then I select which column, that's the column that we saw on this side, and I say okay. There you see, no more suggestions about creating or deleting columns. Now it knows that this column is actually the same as this column here. And the data will remain and I will just have the rename of the column DDL. And the cool part is that this is called a compare mapping. So it will remember, for this design, it will remember it as long as I let it to remember. If I go and delete this compare mapping, it will, of course, not remember it anymore. But if I don't, it will remember it. So if I have the same situation again, I have another version of database with the wrong name of column still, it will remember. It will just tell me it's a rename. So this is called compare mapping. And this is where you see it. Every element in the tool has properties, and also the design has properties. And one of the design properties is compare mappings, and that's why it remembers it. So it's saved on the design. And here it is. Remember that DSC is actually the same as DSC new. But if I don't want to remember, I just go and delete this. And that's it. Very handy. So now we are comparing the database again with another option, with the import and DDL file. So I go and select the DDL file I have, it's here, and I import it to existing relational model if I want to compare. If I just want to document my DDL as a relational model, I go and say new relational model, but I want to compare, so I pick relational one. If I want to have the target and the source the opposite, so which will be compared to which, I go and click this one. Then it's not compared like this, it will be compared like this. And here are the compare mappings we just saw. If you want to see if I have any compare mappings in this design, I just go and click here and I see if I have those. So first I have to tell, so this is the DDL I'm importing, so of course I have to tell which syntax to expect. Because depending on the database, the syntax can be very different. So I tell the tool I'm going to have, let's say, Oracle 12c DDL. It's importing it, it's telling me all the statements, 26 imported, 13, no failed, not recognized statements, 13. And it tells me whatever it's been doing. So it's a proper log, what actually happened when it was importing. If I want to save the log, I can do that. If not, I just say close. And again, the same compare. So Now I can see that I have some changes in employees table, and it's in storage details because it's red, and it's the schema. In source, it has a schema MN, but the target doesn't have any schema. So I can see very detailed what has been changed. And I can get the DDL preview, what will be changed, or what is the SQL I will need. I can save it and I can run it. And then the last one that I can do to compare the design and the database is when I actually import from Data Dictionary. I select the connection. I'm going to use my Heli. I can create as many as I want. These, by the way, these are reporting repository connections, because you can also use a reporting repository to get reports out of the tool. Reporting functionality is fantastic in this tool. I think it's the best part of the tool. There's search and there's reporting, and they're both actually for reporting. Very good. I have another session about that, but not today. Then you select which schemas I want to import. Just Heli, please, nothing else. And again, if I want to swap, not comparing like this, but comparing like this, this is where I tell it. I just go and click this one. And again, the compare mappings can be seen here. So I just want to have one schema. Then I can select which tables, views, users, etc. I want to bring all the tables. I actually unclicked everything else. These are the buttons you can use to select everything or deselect everything. And seven tables were imported. And this is how they look like. So this is my database. And this is my relational model. You can see there's one table that doesn't exist in my relational design, and there's one that actually exists but doesn't exist in the database. So since I'm comparing this way, that's what I've been shown, but if I swap them the other way, I would be shown the opposite. And then again, all the details can be found here. And once again, the drops are deselected by default. So, some things that are good to know. I am not using data model, how can I compare anything? Well, I was just telling you about the DDL import and the data dictionary import. Those work. You can just import to a new design, which doesn't exist yet. So you can just start using it like that. If you have the DDLs for your database, just import them and you will have your design created. Or connect to your database and import from there. Very easy to start. So you import either from database or DDL. Then you can engineer to logical model. There's the button that it's actually two arrows this way, which will create from your relational model a logical model, and you will have all your entities. Then you can just work on your entities, create the tables, the physical model, DDLs, and go again. Very simple. So the tool makes it very easy to move from one phase to another. From logical to relational, you just press a button. From relational to physical, when you have created a physical model, every table you create will be there automatically. Every new column will be there automatically, etc. So it's very, very easy. And if you're working in agile project, I don't know how you survive without this kind of tool. So it's really vital to have a tool. So that's how it happens if you are not using the tool yet. And you can just find it from Google, right there, Oracle SQL Developer Data Model, and it will bring you to Oracle pages. You just say, I agree the terms, and you download it, and that's it. And they don't even send you emails afterwards, no questions or anything. You can just start using it, and nobody will bother you. So another thing, so if you made a mistake, you merged something, you dropped something from your design, you didn't want to do it, of course you have the version control and you go back, but still it's very annoying. Unless you press save, nothing is gone. Just close the design and open it again, because there is no autosave. Only when you press save, it's been saved. So it's very, very easy to go back with your changes if you did it not by purpose. Then there are preferences and properties. I already mentioned that every element has properties. The design, the table, the entity, the column, everything has properties. So those properties will tune the tool to work the way you want. But preferences are even more powerful. There's so many preferences that will affect how the tool looks like, how it will work, how it will actually compare, etc. So I actually put some of those preferences here. I'm not going to read these through, but I put them here in case you start using the tool, you know where to find these. So the preferences I put here are the ones that actually affect the compares or generating DDLs. For instance, if you want to include logging in DDL or include schema in DDL, that kind of things, do you want to show a SHA byte unit for Oracle One SHA-2 or SHA-types? Do you want to create R constraint automatically? That kind of things. Or comparison, do you want to have case-sensitive names incorporated functionality, for instance? Use column order property in compare functionality. So does it matter if they are in same order or can they be in any order as long as the columns are the same? A DDL storage clause, do you want to have all these in the storage clause or not? And relational model, these affect the synchronization. What will be the guiding thing when you're comparing design and database? Will it be the connection you are using, only those elements that are owned by this connection user will be compared, etc. So these will affect that. And then you can also define, like here, I would be very surprised that it doesn't tell me about I have some changes in packages or functions, because I have said don't tell me if you have any changes, don't compare functions and packages for me. This one is also, this one I want to mention, because name substitution is sometimes very powerful. You can change a string when generating DDL. Let's say in production the owner is Heli, but in test it's Test. So you can just, by using name substitution, change every time you're generating DDLs. You can say change Heli to Test because I'm generating DDLs for test environment. So I can just have one physical model with the schema owner Heli. And I can still generate DDLs with a schema owner Test, for instance. So you can change a string to another one when generating DDLs. So the conclusions. Use the same method as you're using with the code. Don't invent the wheel again. Use the same one, whatever it is. I'm sure it's good because you're already using it. Oracle SQL Developer Data Modeler is easy and free to use. And I can say it's easy because I can use it. And even my kids can use it. If you read my book, there's my son who has written a Java program for me. Because if you know Java, this tool will be super powerful because you can do almost anything. There's transformation scripts that can transform many, many things. And only your Java skill is the limit on that, or JavaScript skills. And my son has good skills. You can read from here. And it's integrated to Subversion. As I mentioned, each element is an XML file, which means there's a billion different kind of XML files. If you're trying to manage those by yourself, it will be frustrating. Of course, you can use whatever version control tool, but you have to manage all those files. But when it's integrated with Subversion, the integration will translate those things to you as a normal, understandable things, like a table named customer, instead of having huge XML file name. So it makes life much, much easier to have Subversion integrated in the tool. We have those different compares. You can defer design to a design, design to a database, and database to a design. And when you import whatever you were importing to an existing model, that actually means that you are comparing. And when you are importing it to a new model, new relational model, you're actually documenting something you haven't documented before. For instance, if you want to have a relational model of your existing database, you just import that to a new relational model. So that's the difference. And remember, the preferences and properties make really a difference. And now it's time for questions, and I think my assistant will look after the book. feel free to ask, yes.
As I understood, you mean that you can compare two databases with this tool. But for example, if I have shadowed jobs, will it pick up these jobs too to compare what will change? These jobs itself, will it pick up too or not?
By job, you mean?
As I remember correct, then in Oracle database, yes, you have scheduler, mm-hmm, and you can have some kind of jobs that create tables, mm-hmm, delete them, or do something else. Will it compare these scripts too? Will it pick them up?
My first answer would be no. I haven't actually tested it. But I would say no, but why not? I'll come back to you. Give me your contact and I will get back to you. But my first answer is unfortunately not.
Okay.
But it would be actually very good, because this customer I mentioned earlier, it's not just the data structure, they have everything different. They have asynchronized and synchronized in different servers, and they say it's the same, it's not the same, and that kind of things. There's a lot of things that you should actually know, not just the structures, but everything on top of that as well.
Yes.
Yeah, but I'm afraid they don't give the jobs. Actually, the answer should be on this slide. This one. No jobs. Then probably not.
We can see that there are procedures, probably.
Well, it could be, but I'll test it, yeah, then I know.
Okay.
For sure. Yeah. Could be, but could be not. Because these are relatively new in the tool, so mm-hmm, usually when there's something new coming, it's not perfect in the first release. So
yeah,
that's why my guess is no, but I'm sure it will be there, because the team that is developing this tool, they are just amazing. They are really, really good. I even think about something and they fix it immediately. By the way, when I was preparing this presentation, I found a bug in this new version. So 4.1 is the version just came out about 2 weeks ago or so. And I found a bug when I was preparing a demo for you, and I reported them and they fixed it immediately. I was about to say that it's probably me, just the stupid user, and they said, no, we already fixed it. It was a bug. So they are very, very good. Changing and bringing something I should mention. When you open the tool, there's a start page which will have links everywhere, including the OTN forum. So in the OTN forum, if you ask a question or you suggest something new, they will reply. They are following it all the time. Yeah, but I will check the jobs anyway.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Does it have any advantages working with Oracle databases, or otherwise doesn't have any disadvantages with the others? Also, how does it manage Oracle packages?
The first one is it's much better with Oracle, because this team is working with Oracle development, the database development team. So when there's something new coming with the next release of Oracle, they already know it beforehand. So when the next release of Oracle comes out, this tool already knows it. They don't have this same with SQL Server or DB2, unfortunately, of course. So when the new version of database of SQL Server comes out, they see it the first time. And then they start implementing those things in the tool. So the best thing with Oracle is that it's everything there already when the new version of database comes out. With everything else, it's 1 year later or so, something like that.
Can you give an example of what could be missing with the SQL Server?
Yeah, SQL Server, about 5 years ago, they released a new one which had new data types that were not supported on the previous one. But we had a solution for that, because you can create your own data types here for generating DDLs. So that's what I did. I created my own data type, which was actually the one SQL Server had. But this didn't support it yet. And I get my DDLs the way it was supposed to be for this release of SQL Server. That kind of things. Usually there are small things, but with Oracle, like when partitioning came out, it was very hard to get to the Oracle Designer. It took a long time before we had partitioning Oracle Designer, the previous tool we were using before this. But here it was immediately. So all the things that come as the new things, cool things in a database, we have them here immediately for Oracle. And for everything else a bit later. And the packages, yes, it does support packages.
two questions. So this XML that it exports the version of the database, so is it human readable? So do you need the tool to actually have a look at it and figure out what's changed?
No, it's just an XML. You can compare the XMLs if you want to.
And is it one big file or is it separate files?
Separate files. Well, you actually, starting from 4.1 early adopter, I think, you are able to have one design in one file. Before that, everything was separate files, and I think it's still the best way, because if you're a lot of people working on same design, it's not very nice if one is locking everything.
Okay, and the second question was, does the tool handle data in tables? So you can have some predefined data, or usually it's not just the tables themselves.
Do you mean defaults?
So if you had products in your database, you can have product categories, and you had some predefined categories, so that when you first deploy a database, there are some categories there. So does the tool handle that?
Well, we have, what's the thing called? I think it's the kind of list that you have those values for, this kind of list of value thing.
DDLs, that's the table definition, right?
Mm-hmm.
So but data inside those tables, do you also save that together with the version of the database?
No.
So how do you keep, track of that?
Everything to do with data is actually outside of the scope. So this is just the structures. The data is a separate thing. But if you want to, of course you can create a system for that, because depending where you save your DDLs, the creation of those tables, of course in the same place you can have the SQLs for adding the data. So when you are creating the database, you have everything in the same place in F drive in this directory, and then you run from there, you create the database, and after that you run those SQLs with the data, for instance. But it's good to have everything in one place. And here you can actually have a pointer to that file. That's one way that everything is in the tool. You can have a pointer that I have my data in that file.
So I kind of partially got the answer on my question.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not going to be in this one, unfortunately. Like the case with migrating the data types. It's usually the biggest pain for everyone.
Mm-hmm. It is. That's why it's in the tool, because
but,
they try to find those.
It can identify the spots, but still the manual comparison whether the data conversion, the content will be merged, that's a whole different story.
Yeah, if it's easy, like number to varchar, it can do it. But if it's something more complicated, then not.
Mm-hmm.
Because then human brain needs to be thinking what to do.
Okay. So is there any more questions? Okay.
No more questions.